Laganja Estranja. Next time you death drop, reverse that and drop dead.
Welcome back, fans, to the Complete Guide to Horror podcast. Today, we're discussing Hostel Part 2, released in 2007 on the back of the huge success that was Hostel Part 1, or most commonly known as just Hostel. In the sequel, we catch up with the character of Paxton, the sole survivor of the first movie, and see what happens when a new group, this time centered on three women, fall prey to the evil elite hunting club. Now, personally, I prefer this sequel over the original. It had some really strong, shocking scenes. It also flipped the script of the first installment by giving us a fly-on-the-wall look into who these club members are, why they choose to pay to torture, and also to kill others. What I like about this approach is it adds a new level of storytelling and also adds a new level of unsettling, under-your-skin tension by showing it can be anyone in this hunting club. It could be your neighbor, your buddy, your fellow members of the local PNC community school group. But admittedly, I still think this movie displays a shocking level of misogyny that was also prevalent in the first installment. Coop, have you seen this sequel? And if so, did you like anything about it?
There was sort of an added human side to this one, given that there was one of that little side storyline of that guy whose mate had bought him a subject to kill and murder, and he's like trying to back out, and there's basically like a clause where like you don't leave this place unless you finish this. Yeah, I thought that was an interesting touch, because like absolute evil can get almost comical at times. Like in the first one, I was like, they're all big bad, they're all just like, they're all gonna fuck you up, they're all psycho. But then the idea of someone's in there given the tools to kill, and he's like, oh no, this isn't me, kind of thing, is interesting and kind of more fucked up. So yeah, I thought that was a good touch. I liked that they explored more of the backstory, if you will, in this movie with the elite hunting club and the bidding and all that kind of thing that you get to see in this that you didn't see in the first one. It's not as memorable. When I was rewatching this, I was like, fuck, I don't remember anything about this. The only thing I could remember that it was more gory, but nothing really stands out either. So yeah, definitely not as memorable as the first one, but it was good that they tried to expand on that storyline a lot more and kind of, I guess, as much as you can in a movie like this, try and humanize some of the characters a little bit more so it kind of hits harder. But yeah, overall, still Hostel. Yeah, not really my thing.
I didn't mind the second one. Well, I kind of liked how it was also done from a female perspective this time around. And I think there's maybe like subtle hints, scenes where they imply like some females, like I've been traveling, I've done quite a few Kentuckys, and the thing that I've seen when I've done them is when we go out to a bar and you've got some 18-year-old girl who's never been on a trip before, just getting blind drunk and then just dancing with like a random guy. And I kind of like how this film, I kind of hope this film maybe in a way, if like a female's watching a young female and they're looking to go traveling, is just aware of the surroundings. So I kind of like how they've done a female perspective this time. And I did like that they kind of revisited the same building and then you see the same hotel clerk. And it's sort of the same setup when they walk into the room and they're like, oh, we're going to go down to the pool. I did like how they recreated that scene as well. Yeah, it wasn't too bad. And then I actually, the girl, I don't know who she is. It's one of that's the kind of the dumb, she's not dumb. She's the one, the black hair, the one that goes in the boat down the river.
Yeah.
One of the main girls. She reminds me of like Phoebe from like Friends, like kind of a bit ditzy, but I actually kind of rooted for that character because I wanted her to survive. I know she's kind of like a bit stupid and I think she will just go do whatever. But even in that scene where she's hanging upside down and she's blindfolded, I'm kind of like
she was going to luck her way out of it.
Yeah. Yeah. And can we like talk about that scene though, like with the woman doing the stuff to herself in the blood? I was kind of a bit confused what's going on because it kind of just randomly appeared and she left. I didn't know what was going on.
I had to rewatch the beginning of that movie because I could have thought for sure they snuck in a reference to Elizabeth Bathory, which is the whole, she was this woman that wanted to live forever. So she bathed in the blood of virgin women. So I thought, oh, she did the art class at the beginning of the movie. She must have mentioned it so that we would have caught on later. Couldn't find the reference for it. So I thought, oh, it's a bit weird that they make her this art teacher, but then not talk about this Elizabeth Bathory character who's known in mythology, like sometimes as a vampire, sometimes just like this spurned crazy person that killed innocent women to bathe in their blood. Like I thought they would have taken that approach to it, but No, it was just like a, hey, here's a throwback to a character you may have learned about during history class in school or in art class or something like that. No matter what way you look at this film, it's still about girls getting kidnapped, girls getting captured. And it felt like they were trying to say that it's their own fault for doing so by getting drunk or by taking drugs or by doing something. But they're like, oh, but it's okay because the girl's the one killing them. So it's okay, yeah, guys. Yeah. Don't talk about the politics about it. Yeah.
I think it's good
that things like that, that, you know, yes, this movie was made in 2007, but the whole concept of trying to blame the victim for actions that are done to them is still prevalent back then, still is now. Like, that focus wasn't really done to the men in the first Hostel movie. Like, it showed them getting drunk and taking drugs and going around to, like, the brothels and whatnot, but it was never implied that, like, it's because of their actions. That's why they're stuck in this situation. So, like, that slant in the second movie was a bit unfair. But maybe it was also written that way to make you feel less empathy for the characters, which is stupid because in a horror movie, you should have a lot of empathy for the main protagonist to root for them to win.
Yeah. Mm.
I liked, like you said, Justin, earlier, how they did that sort of, I guess, the montage at the start about, you know, a CEO or someone in their house, like, you know, bidding on these women. Because it's sort of like, it is a scary thought because this stuff does actually happen and you don't really think of it. And when you're watching the movie, it sort of comes to that realization that, like, this stuff does actually happen. So I kind of like how they've sort of put that in there. Maybe like a slight message to people out there, just to, I think it's like a good message, just, you know, be alert and, you know, things like this can happen. But I did like how they went into it more than the first one, because I don't remember from the first one if they didn't really mention much at all. But it was just interesting, the different scenarios of like a business person or like a stay-at-home dad or someone shopping, bidding. It's like you said, anyone next door, someone next door to you could be doing it. You don't know.
Yeah. I would have liked for them to subvert the trope of like the drunk girl getting killed. I would have liked to have been like, maybe the girl does get drunk and she's completely blackout, you know, shout out to Britney Spears, but like gets completely drunk and she doesn't know what she's doing, but she's the one that survives. And instead it's the cautious one that's like, oh no, I'm not doing drugs, I'm not getting drunk, I'm not doing this. And then she's the first one to die. To that trope of no matter how careful you are, if something bad's going to happen to you, it will. That makes it scarier. Also, just a touch base on the opening for Hostel Part 2, I completely forgot that it delves into Paxton, the surviving character from the first one.
Gets his goddamn head cut off.
Yeah. Like, I like any sequel that actually carries a story. And obviously, for the sake of that, they only had one surviving character, so they can't build a whole movie around him. Otherwise, it's the first Hostel again.
All over again.
But I did like... It was a
nice
like,
little nod to the first movie, I thought.
Shows the influence of the elite hunting club as well. Because from memory, him and his girlfriend were in a secluded lake house and they still got him in the end. So it's like, shit, no one's safe. First of all, do I think the portrayal of PTSD is real? Hell no. But I don't think you can do a realistic portrayal of PTSD either. Like, no matter, if you're Meryl Streep, there's always going to be individual experiences with that type of disorder.
Do you and your sister have some form of intellectual disability? Because if I encountered a lake of frozen poo, literally the last question I would ask is, can we ice skate on this?
During the cannibal scene as well, where one of the club members is eating another victim alive, the cannibal is played by none other than Ruggery Deodato, the director of the Cannibal Holocaust movies. Also, I'm pretty certain I said his name wrong, so don't come for me, fans. The director found himself in hot water for animal cruelty in filming scenes for that franchise. And 10 days after its premiere in Milan back in the 80s, Cannibal Holocaust was confiscated under the orders of a local magistrate. Ruggery was charged with obscenity. In January 1981, during the film's theatrical run in France, the magazine, Photo, suggested that certain deaths depicted in the film were real, which would have made Cannibal Holocaust a snuff film. And consequently, the charges against Ruggery were amended to include murder. The courts believed that the actors who portrayed the missing film crew and the native actress featured in the impalement scene were killed for the camera. Now, whether or not you've seen the movie, most people would have seen like images or a video of that impalement scene. It's quite shocking. It's very graphic. What made this more believable was not only the fact that this movie was released before the widespread use of the internet, but also the supposedly murdered actors had signed contracts with the production company, ensuring that they would not appear in any type of media, motion pictures, or commercials for 1 year following the film's release. This was done in order to promote the idea that Cannibal Holocaust was truly the recovered footage of missing documentarians. During the subsequent court proceedings, questions arose as to why the actors were in no other media, if they were alive, as the director claimed. To prove his innocence, Ruggery finally got in contact with the other three actors.
Where the fuck have you been hiding?
And the four of them were interviewed for an Italian TV show. Ruggery also explained in court how the special effect in the impalement scene was achieved. A bicycle seat was attached to the end of an iron pole, upon which the actress sat. She then held a short length of balsa wood in her mouth and looked skyward, thus giving the appearance of impalement. The director also provided the court with pictures of the girl interacting with the crew after the scene had been filmed. So after the court were presented with the evidence, they dropped all murder charges against the director. I like his cameo in Hostel Part 2 as it's a little wink to the diehard horror fans who may know who he is. Also love that there's an irony with him also playing a cannibal. And also, this was a huge fuck you to the courts and media that made his life miserable for those 2 years.
Fuck you.
Thanks, BP and Coop, for joining me. In our next episode, we discuss Hostel 3. Honestly, I don't know why we're doing this episode. The sequel is such a piece of shit, so I can't wait to vent all my anger out on the Vegas set third installment. Jeez, just be prepared, all right? If you like this episode, thank you very much. Please feel free to give us a like, comment, tip, etc. If you didn't like this episode, God, just wait till Hostel Part 3. I think you'll hate that even more.
I'm not enjoying it. I'm not. I hate it. I fucking hate it.
Bye.
Release me from this earth I'm in. Try to maintain that I'm struggling.